Hello everybody and welcome to this presentation. I will be giving you an overview of the activities that we undertake under the genomics lab in Nairobi and specifically under the Dryland cereals program.
We work from a lab which we share with the World Agroforestry Center, which also is known as ICRISAT. This lab has been, when we moved in there, I think that was in 2012, it was a really small lab, but it has grown. And we have three main labs. The first lab is actually for DNA extraction, and that is actually the main lab. And then we have a second facility that we use for doing PCRs. And then recently, with the effort of the African Orphan Crops Consortium, they supported a third lab, which is for next generation sequencing. And we have equipment there for next generation sequencing. This is at the moment purely run by ICRISAT, but we have access to it, and we have been utilizing the lab. So we also do have a data room where we do data analysis. We also have our students or trainees or visiting scientists who are visiting with us. They sit there and do the analysis or checking their emails. And if I'm able to get the mouse, that is which I'm showing right now. And then the lab I'm showing on the left is actually our main lab, which is the DNA extraction lab. The team, we are four of us who are employed by ICRISAT. Vincent currently is the longest serving staff. I joined here and found him. And then Rajneesh joined us, I think, 6 months after I joined as a postdoctoral fellow. And within the last year, Samuel Mandi has joined us. So that is us, as you can see us on the screen. Now, our focus areas, obviously, everything we do is in support of the breeders. We don't do any blue sky research. We basically generate tools that assist breeders in their work. And that is from characterizing germplasm, trying to find out if we can identify novel genes or just use genes that are already existing, find out if we can identify indirect molecular variants that can be used to track or make their breeding more efficient, or if it comes to diseases, we look at ways of easily managing diseases, but also ways of easily screening and getting to their results much, much faster. Now, since we are only four of us in the lab, I mean, there is already a great need for genomic capacity building in the region. And what we do mainly is tie most of our research activities with capacity building. So you'll find most of the times the four of us are not really doing everything. We provide guidance, and most of the time, the students or trainees or visiting scientists who are with us in the lab assist by having hands-on training. As they contribute to our objectives, they also get training on some of the activities that we do. So we have a very strong capacity building component in the lab, and as you will see later, almost every activity we do ties to training. So I'm going to talk about select topics in sorghum. I've chosen to talk about striga resistance. Striga is a very, very significant problem in the region, both for finger millet and sorghum. And so we look into research that is identifying novel genes for resistance to striga, or just using existing ones and utilizing molecular markers in order to introgress the known resistance to new varieties or elite varieties, and also continuing working with getting feedback back and forth with the breeders if we can use those markers to introgress into farmer preferred lines. And also then there are disease resistance in sorghum that also we're researching on at the moment. In finger millet, we're doing more or less the same with striga, but when it comes to disease, blast is the major disease in finger millet, and we've been doing some studies on that as well. Now, because finger millet has been really previously under-researched, there were not sufficient genomic resources for it, So we embarked on developing genomic resources for finger millet, and this has actually been a major part of what we do in the lab. And this is basically the whole genome sequencing of finger millet that we've been doing. And that will be the last thing I talk about. The first project I'm going to discuss is a project that we've been doing together with Abdallah. And for those of you who know Abdallah, I mean, he's done a lot of work on striga in the region even before he joined ICRISAT. So from last year, he was able to give us about 200 accessions, which he has screened over the years, including most of them are actually wild, and these have different responses to striga. And the reason was, I mean, Abdallah had already released some varieties that have resistance to striga, but there was need to incorporate more resistance. So he was basically looking for more novel sources of resistance to striga. And we did this work together in collaboration with ARC Sudan. So we had Rasha Ali, who is on the screen there. We had her come and spend time with us, and we looked at the 100. So out of the 200, we ended up with about 150. And that's probably not the exact figure. But these are different genotypes with which we know their response to striga. So we looked at them. We're actually generating genotyping with sequencing data at the moment. Rajneesh has ended up contributing a lot to this because Russia was not able to be here for a long time, partly also because of funding. And we're hoping that with this, we are able to identify molecular markers or variants that have association with a certain class of response to striga, whether it's immunity or resistance or susceptibility, and use that eventually to be able to validate and then eventually progress this into farmer-preferred variety. Now, similar to that is also a project that we've been doing with Abdallah on striga resistance. And for this, we engaged a PhD student, Clete Masiga, who you can see on the screen there as well. Now, this was different in that we wanted to make use of already existing genomic resources. So you have sorghum has been resequenced a lot of data has been generated that is in the database from different institutions. So what Clete did was, at the beginning, he had discussions with University of Georgia, which is where, you know, the reference genome for sorghum was generated, Cornell University, where they regularly generate a lot of genomics data, ICRISAT, of course, and one of the institutions in China. And out of the genotypes for which there were already genomic data, he collected them, and especially the ones that have relevance to the region, he collected them. And then Abdallah added certain genotypes, which I think some of them were released last year, actually, but for which data had not been generated, but for which he knows their response to striga. And so Clete has been screening these this germplasm over almost 2 years now in Kenya and Uganda, two seasons, and an additional screening was done in Kenya, where we had one site with striga, which is a striga sick plot, and another one without striga. And right now he has a lot of data, and we are trying to generate that. So what's going to happen is we're going to use already existing genomic data, add it together with the phenotypic data, and be able to see if we can analyze and figure out if we can find molecular markers that are associated with some novel sources of resistance, basically from the genotypes that Abdallah released last year. And then a more downstream analysis we've been doing with Eric Manyasa from last year. Unfortunately, this has had to stop this year because of lack of funding. But this was the first major integration project that we did. So basically using known sources of resistance, which Eric wanted to integrate into elite varieties, and those elite ones are Seredo Nakadabo, and the two you see there, N13 is actually was used as the source of resistance. So instead of just doing conventional backcrossing, which is what has been done here, you are supporting in terms of using molecular markers that have already been identified in N13 to determine which ones are successful, and every generation be able to remove the ones that are not containing the relevant genes. So basically what is done when you don't have molecular markers is you have to wait for that plant to grow to maturity to see its response to Striga for you to decide this is the one that has what we have. But what we were doing with Eric is we do it at seedling stage and we discard what does not have the right gene. And that was a very good learning for us. Now, unfortunately for this, we had to use SSR, which is SSR technology is relatively old now and it's becoming really expensive. And sometimes because we have to outsource the results, it might take long. But if we want to get the results at seedling stage, then we had to look for a way of utilizing the markers that we had in a more efficient way. So what we did was we didn't go through, so the first season we actually went through the long process of submitting the samples for fragment analysis at Becca, but that really took a long time because it also coincided with the time when I think there was Christmas holiday. So it took a long time. By the time we came back, the plants had already grown. And I think during this season, they grow really, really fast. So for the second season, we had to be smart. And what we decided was because we could convert the SSRs into a more efficient way of screening, what we did was we converted them to high-resolution melting, which is something that we could actually just analyze within the lab. And that worked quite successfully. So from all the many plants that we had, we were able to narrow down to 27, which had the right genes that we were looking for. So this, unfortunately, has stalled for now, but hopefully funds available, we will be able to continue and see how far it takes us. But this is now going to feed back, the experiences we learn from here will feed back to the new ones we are identifying right now. So we are just in the process of identifying novel sources. What we were trying to introduce here is relatively old. But whatever experience that we learn from here, we go back every time we identify novel sources, then we identify the right markers that are efficient and eventually use them for breeding so that within a period of time, we stop doing purely conventional but look into more efficient ways of breeding. Now, another sorghum study that both Eric and Rajneesh have been doing together is in terms of trying to identify variants that are associated with disease resistance. So these are genotypes that Eric had already screened in Western Kenya for two seasons, and he knew the response to anthracnose and to blight. And so Rajneesh simply used that phenotypic data and generated genotypic data, which he was able to use to be able to determine what variants are associated with disease resistance. So it's going to be difficult for this set of data for us to determine exactly which ones are associated to one particular disease because the two diseases were screened at the same time. But eventually, when we are doing validation, when we create biparental populations for validation, we can determine which particular markers are associated with which particular disease. So this analysis is also just being concluded right now. Now, a final project that I'm going to talk about under sorghum is one that has been done in collaboration with the Ethiopian Institute for Agricultural Research. This was done by TESFAI, who you can see on the screen there. TESFAI has spent quite a bit of time on and off with us here. And what TESFAI did was he was able to identify a new source of stay green material in Ethiopia. Now, what he did then was cross this with one of the popular varieties there, Gambela, and at F2, which is where they're segregating and you're able to see the differences, he came and did the genotyping here with us. At that time, he did SSR markers. As I already mentioned, this is already quite an old technology and it can get very expensive. But he did this quite successfully, and he was able to identify some QTLs. He could not do that for stay green because stay green is a quantitative trait. At F2, it's too early to be able to really determine what is contributing. But we was able to do an initial analysis, and what I'm showing there on the screen is just showing we were trying to determine how good the population is, and we could really determine that because you can imagine something like grain weight. Usually, if you want to look at grain weight and how it's contributing to your genotype, and you see something like panicle weight, I mean, usually they are correlated. You'd expect them to be correlated. And actually, from his data, we could see that whatever it is that we found to be linked to grain weight, we also found to be linked to panicle weight, which gave us confidence that this was a good population. And so he has advanced it now to F5. And at F5, we've invested a little bit more, and we're generating genotyping by sequencing data, which is going to give us a lot more information. And then we can do mapping of stay green. And Josiah is just finalizing his thesis right now. Part of the reason why we had to do the genotyping at F5, because it would be better at more advanced generation, but he has to complete his thesis now. So those are the major highlights in sorghum breeding. Now I'm going to go into finger millet breeding. And the first also I'll just talk about is striga resistance. This work has been done in collaboration with Calro Kakamega. So Chris, who is the guy who we were collaborating with at that time, was in Kakamega. Now he has moved to another institution. But there's a student who was working on the genotypes who is registered at the University of Eldoret. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a photo for him, but I've respectfully put his name there in bold. And so Peter Sirengo worked on the, he did the screening of about 100 accessions in two locations. So you realize most of Striga screening is done in Western Kenya because that is where you have the hotspots for Striga. So he did in two locations, in Alupe and Kibos, and he did them in two seasons, so during the long rains and short rains in the two sites. And the data he generated, we combined together and generated genotyping data. He did all the gene extraction here, and we sent it for genotyping by sequencing. Now, the analysis of this data has been done by Rajneesh a lot, so that's why you see Rajneesh there on the screen. And using that data, we are actually just finalizing now to get if we can to detect any associations for striga resistance. So you realize that not a lot of work has been done on finger millet in terms of determining striga resistance lines or any QTLs associated with striga resistance. So this is going to be a really good study. And it's unfortunate that at the time they had only screened a few, you know, I mean, 100 might seem a lot to some of you, but that is not sufficient enough to be able to get confidence in what we're doing. But eventually when we are able to screen even more and then validate some of what we will have found here in biparental populations, it will actually give us really novel material or novel results in terms of striga resistance in finger millet. Now, the other thing I wanted to say is we've also learned a lot from this. So as I was mentioning, we don't have much genomic resources in finger millet. Now, initially when we generated the genotyping with sequencing data, we were trying to analyze it, you know, just blindly. But you know that finger millet is a tetraploid, and it becomes really challenging to be able to determine. If it's a tetraploid, it means it has combined two genomes in one. So long time ago, two similar species joined together and created finger millet. So it's very difficult to be able to resolve or to analyze this kind of data unless you have generated enough genomic resources to be able to know whatever you're identifying belongs to genome AA and another one belongs to the alternative genome. So we tried to do this analysis initially, but we were not able to make much success. And this is one of the projects for which generating the whole genome sequence of finger millet has really, really helped, because the difference we've been able to see from when we didn't have one and when we have now is just huge. but I'll mention that in the last slide. And of course, yeah, I mean, Dresnish has contributed significantly to that project. Now, in terms of generating gene information in finger millet, which also is really does not exist, we tied this again with the problems in the region, and we decided we're going to do this with striga and blast disease. Now, Eric, who is here and who already introduced himself, did an analysis in terms of trying to understand gene expression in response to striga. What happens within the plant when striga infects it? And since this has not been done before in finger millet, we decided to do like a pilot study. So we did this in collaboration with Massena University. So we have Matthew Zida, who is based there, who has done a lot of work on response to striga in finger millet. He gave us four genotypes, two which we show susceptibility and two that show resistance. And so what Eric did was initially to be able to optimize conditions so that he can know exactly at what stage what is happening within the plant instead of just doing it blindly. So Eric optimized and looked at the different stages that are critical and at what point they are. And he was able to identify, for example, if you can see from the screen, he was able to confirm that germination of striga in the presence of finger millet happens 3 days after infection. So once you put the striga in a place where finger millet seed is available, it will take it roughly 3 days to germinate. And if you can see that from the screen, you can see some protrusions there. And then, so there are three critical stages for striga infestation. When it's in the presence of a cereal, a host cereal like finger millet or sorghum, it will take time. It will first of all germinate, and then it will try to elongate its haustoria to the root of the cereal, and then it will try to attach and then penetrate if the host is susceptible. So those are the critical stages we want to look at germination stage. What is happening within the plant? Because at that, even as early as that, at that time, there's something already happening in the plant that we need to identify. So he was able to identify the number of days. Now I don't know how to go back. Yeah, he was able to identify the period taken at germination, attachment. If you can see from that picture there, that is. Trying to attach to the root of a finger millet. And then here, it's really blown, but if you can see, it's actually trying to penetrate and get into the root. So once we determined those, then we went ahead to be able to extract RNA and to be able to get gene expression information at those critical stages, looking at the susceptible genotype, but also looking at the resistant genotype, so that we can look at the differences. What is it that is not happening or happening in the resistant one that we can use to learn on how striga is manipulating the susceptible ones to be able to exploit it? And so far, Eric has done a really good job and is just finalizing his data analysis. I forgot to mention that Eric has also received a scholarship, partial scholarship from the Dryland Series program. So he has a scholarship that he's using to complete his master's at the moment. Now, we also did the same, something similar with blast, resistance to blast. This was done by Davis Gimode. He has since gone to do his PhD at the University of Georgia. He also did an excellent job. Working together with Massena University, again, we identified two genotypes that are resistant and two that are susceptible to blast. He was able to isolate a blast from the field, cultured it, and then used it to infect these genotypes. And then, So in this case, we did not go into optimization of the time points because this blast is the same as the blast in rice, and a lot of work has been done on rice. And so we just we used the time points that have been used in rice, and he simply collected and looked at the RNA from inoculated samples at control time before you expose it to the pathogen, 18 hours after you expose it to the pathogen, 36 hours and 72 hours, and then generated all that data and did a similar analysis as what I mentioned that Eric has been doing. Now, this has also, well, I'm hoping that he's concluding this now, but we should be able to, from the study with Eric and Davis, we should be able to identify certain genes that are only active at different stages in some particular classes, you know, whether it's only in resistant or only in susceptible, and use those eventually to be able to determine whether those genes are responsible for something that is either inhibiting or enhancing the activities of the pathogen or of the host. Okay, and then that brings me to the final activity I was going to mention today, which is the whole genome sequencing of finger millet, which was basically done to be able to generate genomic resources that we can eventually use for breeding. Now, this has been going on since last year, April, and this was done in collaboration with the African Orphan Crops Consortium. If you want to know more about AOCC, which is how it is abbreviated, you can go to that website, which is given there. Now, the funding we received to be able to carry out this work was given by BioInnovate. Again, if you want to know more about BioInnovate, the website is there. So this project, like any other genome sequencing project, involves a number of partners, so many partners. But I've just highlighted some, and it's still ongoing, so we are likely to be receiving more partners. I've just highlighted a few on the screen there. And of course, Davis and Eric, since they were already working on something, they also contributed to the sequencing, the whole genome sequencing of finger millet. There were three main objectives, as I've already mentioned, to create to generate genomic tools. But also, we need to understand, you know, what exactly is the reference genome of finger millet to be able to really understand, you know, be able to unravel what are some of the genes that could be unique in finger millet. I mean, now we know that finger millet is very nutritious, it has high levels of micronutrients. Are we able to really see what is it that is within the finger millet genome that is different from other crops, or within one genotype that is very nutritious or very resistant versus another? So it was necessary for us to be able to generate that whole genome information to make it easier for us to understand the genome, but also to be able to breed it faster. And something else that I didn't mention, even though finger millet came about as a result of merging of two genomes, one of the donor genomes is known, which is the AA genome, but the second one is not known. We don't know whether it's gone extinct or whether it exists somewhere. By generating this kind of data, we would be able to know, because this is where also finger millet is natively from this region, the region around Ethiopia and Uganda. We still have most of the wild accessions growing side by side with finger millet. If we are able to generate the whole genome information, and we know these other ones growing in the wild, are we able to really determine which one is the other donor parent? And once we know that, we can then unravel the two genomes and be able to know really how this crop is evolving, and also be able to know how we can utilize those other wild relatives that are close to it, which might be having other novel traits that we can exploit, for example, extreme drought tolerance. So that's part of the reason that we wanted to do that. But at the same time, to build capacity. I mean, there are very few breeders in finger millet, but there are very few, there are actually probably no breeders in the region who are actively using molecular markers to enhance the breeding of this crop, which is a very beautiful crop. The yield is still so very low, but finger millet can can do just as well, if not even better, than things like wheat. You know, everything that that wheat could have, finger millet has, and much more. So we need to build capacity in the region, have young upcoming scientists who really understand how best to exploit this genome to get it to be what exactly we expect it to be. And so part of this activity was to train a lot of scientists in the use of genomic resources. So, I mean, we've actually finalized on the whole genome sequencing. We've been able to generate, I mean, for those of you who are interested in knowing the details, we've been able to generate and assemble about 1.3 gigabases of data for finger millet. This is not released yet, but the estimated genome size is about 1.45. So usually, most of the times, you don't need to have the exact same size of what is the estimated size, because, you know, part of it is repetitive elements, part of it is regions close to the centrum here, which you can't really assemble that well. But for our breeding purposes, you know, we are not interested in getting a perfect, complete genome for finger millet. We want enough information to be able to assist us in breeding and getting things to the farmer. So what we have here is just more than sufficient. Now, after generating that the genome sequence, we also needed to find out, you know, what components of that genome has genes that are active. And so we looked at genes that are expressed in roots, stems, leaves, seeds, at various stages of development. And most of this has been done by the Beijing Genomics Institute, because they're really very efficient in generating that kind of data. But we've also added together the data generated by Eric and Davis for response to BLAST and response to Striga to be able to identify which components of the genome that we've sequenced and generated really has active genes that are responding or that are being expressed or induced in terms of response to BLAST or disease striker resistance. So other than this, the other thing that we've done is in the process of generating the whole genome sequence, we've actively collaborated with Becca, Irie, and some other collaborators to be training people from the region in terms of, you know, how do you generate a whole genome sequence. Because, I mean, most of us, we see it's a big deal. We see papers published in Science or Nature, but we don't really know what goes on in the process. And how can you utilize that information to make your breeding more efficient? So we've been having training continuously the last almost 16 months now, and this is coming to a conclusion, but the capacity building will continue. So the general capacity building activities that we have in the lab, I just wanted to show. So we have usually a lot of people, students coming as interns. Some of you have seen them, and sometimes you've wondered, you know, how many are we hosting, because we tend to always have so many. But we have interns at bachelor's level. We have postgraduates coming to spend time with us. And we also have people who come for short-term training. And sometimes we also organize group training, as you see. So, I mean, we've had so many students coming in and out over the last years. But I was just highlighting some of the ones we've had specifically under Dryland cereals. Some of those spaces, you've already seen them. And as I mentioned already, the capacity building also tries to take into account the gender balance. So we try to have as many women as we have men. For the theme specific workshops, we've also done these mostly in collaboration with Becca Ilri, but we also sometimes have a project in which capacity building is incorporated. Now, this is just to show one of the GBS workshops we did in collaboration with Cornell University and Becca Ilri. Recently, just last 2 months, we've also had another series of workshops with Cornell University, and we did one of the workshops in Ethiopia. So the one I'm showing on the screen there was done in Ethiopia, but we had a similar one done here. And so just in summary, what is the future of genomics research for serial projects here? I mean, we are really hoping that given the right capacity, we can move serial breeding in the region to be what it should be, and that is utilizing the most efficient resources available to make sure that we provide to the farmers what they need through the breeders. And we are hoping that we continue with the characterized, especially striga. I mean, it's really a significant problem in cereals, and it's really specific to the region. So there's a lot of work that we're doing that is going on striga resistance. So we want to understand striga a little bit more. You know, what are the biotypes? How are they affecting some of the breeding lines that we are coming up with? A lot of breeding programs have moved from doing marker-assisted selection. So marker-assisted selection basically uses a few molecular markers you identify from the genome. So they could be five, or sometimes they're even just one if you have a diagnostic one. So most of breeding projects that are quite advanced have moved from using just a few markers to using genomic selection, where you have information from the whole genome. Because the fact that you have one marker associated or one gene associated with striga response may not really mean that is the one actually responsible when you take it to the field. When you take it to the field, so many other things happen and there's so many things interacting. So the best and the most efficient way is actually to look at the whole genome and look and see what are the combinations of genes or variants that are actually contributing to the superior performance that you see. And this requires a lot of bioinformatics knowledge. It requires a lot of generation of high throughput data. And that is actually where we should be aiming. And we are hoping that we should be able to do this in the near future. And for finger millet, we'll continue to generate novel information and also utilize now the genome, whole genome sequence that is available to be able to make the breeding much, much faster. And in both finger millet and sorghum, we are hoping that we can come up with the relevant populations that we can use to be able to do more efficient breeding. I can see some of you are dozing off now, especially somebody I know very well. So I'm going to conclude. In summary, there are a lot of opportunities we have in the region. There are so many things we can do. I mean, most of you, many times you've seen between the four of us in the lab, our hands are really full. But that's not a bad sign. It means there's really so much we can do with the required necessary capacity and support from all of you and from our donors. We really can do a lot, and we are hopeful that we can end up doing a lot more together with capacity building alongside, so that we create a critical mass and this need, there's a demand for utilization of genomic resources for breeding in the region. So just want to acknowledge my collaborators, the breeders, the farmers, and all these guys who contributed. I probably didn't have enough space to put all the logos there, but I'm quite grateful to all the support that I get from everybody else who has contributed to our activities. That's it. Thank you so much. I hope you have questions, and even if you don't, you can always send me a message.